be broken. I'm going to be looking to God's word in just a few moments in James chapter 1. I have been doing a study in 1 Corinthians, but this week I really felt led to go back to James chapter 1 because if ever there was a time we needed to find joy in our lives, that time is now. I mean, this is a time we need to look for joy, and I believe we can find it not only in the present crisis, but in all the struggles of life. We can find joy in God. I want to dedicate this song to one of our precious church members, Helen Harris. Helen, I don't know if you're watching or not, but you can watch this later. And Helen loves this song. I sang it before, and some of you will know it. There's an old gospel song about crossing over Jordan to go and be with God. I'm only going over Jordan, only going home. So sing along if you know it. This is for our dear sister in Christ, Helen Harris.
I am a poor wayfaring stranger while traveling through this world of woe. Yet there's no sickness toward the danger in that bright land to which I'll go. I'm going there to see my Father. I'm going there no more to roam. I'm only going over Jordan. I'm only though dark clouds may hang around me, I know my way is rough and steep. The beauteous fields lie just before me, where God's redeemed their vigil keep. I'm going there to see my mother. She said she'd meet me when I come. I'm only going over Jordan. I'm only going.
Jesus, I'm going there no more to roam. Hope the song bless you and encourage you tonight. Whatever struggles and trials we're going through, we know there's a better place waiting in heaven. Until that day comes, God calls us to faithfulness, to trust in Him and look to Him, be faithful, serving God every day, shining Jesus's light to a lost and troubled world. I asked you a moment ago to have your Bibles ready in James chapter 1, a familiar passage. And this past week, God led me back to this passage, because as I prayed and prayed for you, I prayed for the congregation at Greenfield. I know you all pray for me. I pray for you every day as I pray for my wife and my sons and my grandchildren. And I pray for you as well, all of you. And I know you pray for me. I can feel it. If I feel a little down and struggling, I know my family, my church family, my brothers and sisters in Christ are praying for me. Believe me, I need it, and I can certainly feel it. So if ever there's a time we need to reexamine how to have joy in the midst of life struggles, my friends, that time is now. Wouldn't you agree? because on top of everything else we struggle, we have this larger situation going on. Record numbers of people out of work, people losing their jobs. Every time I turn around, I talk to someone who has lost their job, and I'm praying for you who've lost your jobs, that God will open the right doors for you to find employment, whatever it needs to happen. And so out of these struggles, we're praying that good things will happen in your life. And keep trusting God. Hang in there. I want to talk about how to have joy even in the midst of our struggles. So James chapter 1, beginning verse 1 down to verse 8, says this: James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes scattered among the nations, greetings. Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. Let perseverance finish its work, so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. If any of you lacks wisdom, you should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to you. But when you ask, you must believe and not doubt, because the one who doubts is like a wave of the sea, blown and tossed by the wind. That person should not expect to receive anything from the Lord. Such a person is double-minded and unstable in all they do. Amen. May God bless his word as we've read it together, and enrich our hearts through your holy word, O God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. As I said, this past week, I felt led to go back, look at James chapter 1, about what it means to find joy in the struggles that we have. And in the present situation, I was led back to this book, this wonderful, powerful book of the New Testament. James challenges the church, and that's you and I. He challenges believers to count it all joy when you face all kinds of trials. So right off, I want to find myself doing some crucial things. And I want to remind you of the four things I challenged you with recently. Right in the midst of all this, I realized, Lord, help me to keep doing what I've been doing. Help the believers that are going through this, as we all are, keep doing the right things. So one is pray. Keep on praying. Secondly, stay in the word. Keep going to God's word every day. Memorize scripture like you've never memorized it. Delve into God's word like you've never delved into it before. Have God's word in your heart, in your mind, so that when you get discouraged, when you get down and out, when you feel like complaining, when you get just really discouraged, you've got scripture in your mind, in your heart. You've got God's word as a lamp unto our feet, a light to our path. And you've got God's word to help us to be encouraged. As I'm always quoting Psalm 34:1, I'll bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth, on my lips. Praise God and look to him. So pray, stay in God's word, connect with others. As a pastor, this does me such good to see you all connecting here during these live streams. People saying hello to each other. Hey, how's everybody doing? Some of you chatting back and forth. That's great. Do that. Doesn't distract me at all. It encourages me to see you encouraging one another, interacting with one another. And that's the third thing I'm encouraging you to do. Don't isolate yourself. You know, don't disconnect. Connect. Stay connected with people, especially during these times. And for those folks who are in nursing homes and hospitals, they are going through such a difficult time, can't have visitors. But if at all possible, call those folks on the phone and encourage them. I do volunteer work at the Bristol Regional Medical Center as a chaplain, and I can't go visit folks right now. So what we're doing is, if somebody has a need for a chaplain, they call whoever one of us is on call. We can talk them on the phone and pray with them. And I've done some of that and prayed with hospital patients on the phone, try to offer encouragement to them. Stay connected. All right, so you getting these? Pray. Stay in the word. Stay connected. Connect with each other. The fourth thing is envision what God is going to do. Get a vision for what God's going to do, this great awakening that's going to happen. I believe it's coming. A great awakening where people are going to come back to church. They're going to give their faith, give their hearts to Christ. They're going to come back to church in record numbers. We're going to see an outpouring of God's Spirit unlike anything we've seen in our lifetimes. So as we're doing all these things, keep trusting God. When we feel ourselves getting discouraged, and we will. I got real down and out yesterday. I was going through my day at work at the school bus garage, and we're delivering meals to kids, and I'm teaching CPR classes and getting people caught up on their CPR certifications. A lot of things going on. I don't know. I just got a feeling down. So I had to stop a while and just pray and ask God to give me strength and encouragement. I started falling back on these things I was talking about staying God, about praying, staying in the Word, connecting, and envisioning what God is going to do. It brought me up out of it. God brought me up out of that period of discouragement I felt yesterday. It was such a good feeling to walk up out of that with God's strength and by God's power. And I know you can do the same. So keep seeking God and how to better understand how God can use this to his glory and draw us closer to him. Remember these biblical principles that I've shared with you, and it so applies to the present situation. Now, James here is not telling us to be happy because something bad has happened. Rather, he's telling us that we can find joy in the midst of our struggles. And so we're going through a hard time, yes, but by trusting God, we can find joy and peace even in the midst of it. Now, what this is a state of mind. It becomes an attitude, which comes from prayer, as I said a moment ago, from seeking God and finding peace regardless of the storms that are raging all around us. Here's what happens as a result of that, my friends. Rather than worry or fret or get angry or despair or become hopeless and afraid, we make a choice. We're going to trust God no matter what, whatever happens. Lord, we make a decision, a commitment. It's a confession. Lord, I will trust you no matter what. God, come what may, I will trust you, Lord. Having taken a stand upon Jesus Christ, having trusted you, O God, having applied your word to my heart and my mind and believed it, Lord, I will trust you, Lord, no matter what. I won't back down. I won't quit. I won't surrender. I won't give up, Lord. I won't abandon you, O God, because you'll never abandon me. It's a state of mind, you see. I'm going to trust God no matter what. Now, we're empowered to do that when we pray. We seek God. We look to the Lord. We stay in his word. We worship together. And what a blessing it'll be when we come back together corporately in worship. But I'll tell you, I felt God's presence, God's spirit. And I've said it every time when I sing these songs. And I can hear you sing along with me. I can just sense you singing along with me. What a blessing it'll be to get back to church, hear our pianist Ruth play the piano and accompany us and the choir sing. And love you all so much. Can't wait to hear you all sing with you. And we're looking forward to that day, hopefully very soon, that we can get back together in church. And so this is a frame of mind that God gives us as we pray, as we seek him. We choose to trust God no matter what. When Jesus said that, you know, if we want to follow him, be his disciple, we must daily deny ourselves, take up the cross and follow him. So that is a decision we make every day to trust in God. Now, in James 1 here, God challenges his people, God, you know, challenging us in his word to count it all joy when we face trials. And the reason for this is explained in verse 3. For you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. You know the testing of your faith, it produces perseverance. Now, what is perseverance? Perseverance means I keep going. Even when I feel like giving up, I keep going. I don't quit. I don't surrender. I don't lie down in defeat. You might have done that. You might have lied down in defeat, but if you trust God, he'll get you back on your feet again, get you going. You don't quit. You don't surrender. Persevere means even when I feel like giving up, I don't. Even when I feel like surrendering, I don't. Even when I'm so down, discouraged, and tired, rather than give up, I rise up with God's strength, God's help, and I keep going. That's perseverance. You ever, you know, you were having troubles at work and you didn't feel like going, but you did anyway. You were having health issues, you didn't feel like getting up and rising out of bed and doing therapy, whatever it was you're going through. I can relate to that because, as you'll know, back in December, you know, I messed up my shoulder. And there've been days I didn't feel like doing the physical therapy, but I did. I'm still doing those exercises at home, and I find it makes such a difference. Even when I don't feel like doing it, I persevere and keep doing it. Praise God, I was able to avoid rotator cuff surgery because of the therapy, and I'm so thankful for that. This is perseverance. And so the testing of our faith produces perseverance. When our faith is tested, it more empowers us to keep going when we otherwise would have given up. Now, Greenfield Baptist folks, you've heard me preach on this before, and you've heard me say that our faith is like a muscle that grows when it is stretched. Word of God also says that our faith is like gold that is refined in the fire. But think for a moment, if you would, about that muscle being stretched analogy. I'm ever thankful in my life for the joyful, peaceful, calm, happy life moments when it just seemed like everything was going my way. And my ministry was being blessed. My work with the school system was being blessed. My family was all in such a good place. And my sons were thriving, and they are. I'm thankful for that, all three boys grown and thriving and doing so well in their jobs, and God is blessing them. All of course, right now, this is such a hard time, but you know what I'm talking about. Everything's going great. And I'm so thankful for those calm, happy, quiet moments. But quite honestly, my faith is enhanced for sure, but that's not when my faith grows. You understand that our faith grows in the hard times. Our faith grows when we feel like we're being just pushed to the very limits of what we can endure. I know it's just Wednesday night, but I'm preaching, right? Amen. We're pushed to the very limits of what we can endure. And we feel like, I just can't go on, Lord. And we feel like giving up. But we persevere. This is when our faith is stretched. This is when our faith grows. If you would consider 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 7 through 12. Paul the Apostle told the church about the struggles he's been through, about the struggles the other apostles have been through, what has happened to them. In 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 7 through 12, Paul tells the church, he says, but we have this treasure in jars of clay. Your translation might say earthen vessels. That means us in these frail, flawed vessels, these bodies. We have God's Holy Spirit. We have God's Spirit in us. This is the treasure in these earthen vessels, these jars of clay. We're so fragile, yet God's given us this great gift of His Spirit. Treasure in jars of clay, I'm still in verse 7, to show us this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us. We are hard-pressed on every side, but not crushed. Perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not abandoned. Struck down, but not destroyed. We always carry around in our body the death of Jesus so that the life of Jesus may also be revealed in our body. For we who are alive are always being given over to death for Jesus' sake so that his life may also be revealed in our mortal body. So then death is at work in us, but life is at work in you. Amen. I love what Paul said there. He said, we are hard pressed on every side. They were suffering persecution, difficulties, trials of every kind. He said, you know, we're perplexed. He said, we're pressed on every side, but not crushed. Perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not abandoned. Struck down, but not destroyed. This is that perseverance that James is talking about. Our faith is stretched. The trials come. Our faith is tested. When our faith is tested, it grows. It produces perseverance. And, you know, remember what verse 3 says, it produces perseverance. It gives us that strength, that power to keep going. Now, verse 4 says this, let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, lacking nothing. So we're not only sometimes pressed on every side, we might suffer some form of persecution. We pray for our missionaries around the world who are being persecuted for their faith, for believers being persecuted. We have missionaries in other countries who are in countries where if they openly preach the gospel, it can cause them all sorts of problems. They might be ran out of the country. They might be physically assaulted. And there's also Christian groups around the world who are being persecuted because of their faith and people trying to silence them. So persecution goes on. Maybe you feel persecuted. Maybe you feel like you're the only believer at your workplace. Maybe you've got a family member who is an unbeliever that maybe scoffs at you because of your faith in Christ. That is a form of persecution. Maybe you feel emotionally exhausted. You know, you're so tired, emotionally, physically tired. God understands. This is when our faith is tested. We keep persevering. Maybe you just feel spiritually frazzled. just spiritually down. You try to pray, but you can't concentrate. You feel like your prayers are going no higher than the ceiling. And this is when our faith grows. During those times, when I have found myself on my knees, crying out to God, praying for strength, and the Spirit himself, according to Romans 8:26, was interceding for me with groanings that cannot be uttered, that was when growth happened. Hope that makes sense to you. During those times when I was just so distraught, I didn't have the words. I was on my knees seeking God. I was so discouraged, so distraught. I couldn't even speak. I could only groan, maybe weep, crying out to God. And the Spirit then came and interceded for me, prayed to God for me on my behalf. That is when the spiritual growth happened. That stretching process happened. And I came through that a stronger Christian, a better person, a stronger, more committed disciple of Jesus Christ. And afterwards, when the dust of the present crisis began to settle, I realized I'd grown. And here's how I had grown. This is for you as well. I'd grown in faith. I'd grown in personal resolve. I'd grown in my walk with Christ. I was walking closer with Jesus. I experienced the perseverance that comes only by faith. And then empowered to do God's word, to do God's will, to do as God's word says, be mature and complete, not lacking anything. I was empowered to do God's will and do what God says in his word, to be that mature Christian, that complete Christian. That doesn't mean I stop growing. This is an ongoing process. We're ever maturing in Christ, ever growing in Christ, not lacking anything. We keep building on that. We keep going. Now, we will get through this, my friends. I believe God is going to bring us through this current darkness, this current crisis, but we won't get through it without firm and unyielding faith. This is where the joy is. Firm and unyielding faith. I want to challenge you tonight. Make a daily choice to become the best persons we could possibly be. Smile when you don't feel like it. Pray for people when you don't feel like it. Love others when you don't feel like it. Shine Jesus's love everywhere we go, even when you don't feel like it. You might be quarantined at home, but you can still go on the phone and call people and encourage them. Maybe you can only go out in your front yard. Encourage your neighbor if you can, with social distance, of course. Amen. And encourage people around you in any way that we can. Help one another. Love one another. Stay connected. Keep moving towards that better, brighter day. Now, since the COVID-19 crisis began, we've all had to make adjustments to our lives, haven't we? I mean, seriously, we've had to make adjustments. And the implications for this are going to be felt for a long time. And I've been seeking to spread a message in my preaching, in my teachings, that out of the ashes of this global pandemic, God's going to do something unprecedented. I think he already is. I see God moving in people's lives in very real, very special ways. And so, again, this is where the joy comes. We take a step back. We look at our priorities. If we choose to see this as a growth challenge, we'll find our faith, our personal resolve stretched and cultivated, which leads us to be those stronger Christians, the stronger disciples of Jesus than we were before. Amen to that. If taken with the right approach, the present crisis can lead to some amazing God-centered results. Spiritual growth takes place. Personal growth takes place. Thanksgiving, thankfulness takes place. You might find yourself hopefully more thankful for those simple blessings. You know, the most simple blessings, having a roof over our heads, food to eat, a place to sleep at night. Those things that we might have once taken for granted, we no longer take for granted anymore. Just so much as having something to eat, some food in our pantry, something to eat each day, fresh water to drink, a roof over our heads, shoes to wear. We're more thankful for those things. Getting to come to church, getting to see family members face to face. Hopefully, we won't take those things for granted anymore. Our perceptions change, hopefully for the better. Hopefully, we become more thankful for the seemingly smaller things in life. Have you been spending more time outside in the sunshine? Have you been doing some more gardening? Maybe some more reading? I joke about how that since the COVID pandemic came on, I've got my reading groove back on. I'm trying to get my exercise groove back on. I'm trying to get my healthy eating groove back on. I don't know about you all, but during this whole thing, I have been craving junk food. Do you like that? And I've been having to lay off the junk food, if it's nerves or what it is, but I'm getting trying to get my healthy eating, my exercise, my reading groove, all these healthy things back on. And so I see that as very positive. Hope these good things are happening to you. Reconnecting with old friends, as we're doing here tonight. Amen. Examining budgets, re-examining our budgets. What can I live on now that I have to? Incomes have been down, folks losing jobs. What can I live on now? We're having to re-examine our budgets. Taking stock of our lives, what's truly important to us. If you're doing that, if you're doing all those things, you're not despairing but trusting God, then you are on a great spiritual path to growth, growing through all of this rather than being brought down by it. This is what God would call us to. You're hopefully finding that you're stronger than you think you are. And God is working your life in ways you could not have imagined. I read a wonderful story the other day. Writer Leo Buscaglia, I read some of his books back in the 1980s, and I recall something that he said in one of his books. I had to go back and look this up, but he told a story about how his mother fixed their misery dinner once. He said that one night his father came home from work and he gathered the family around and he said, "I've got bad news." He said, "I've lost everything in my business." He said, "My business partner, I found out today, absconded with all the money that we had." Basically, he said, "I'm broke, have nothing. I've been swindled. And right at this moment, I'm broke. I have no money." He said, "I don't know what we're going to do." Leo Buscaglia said his mother quietly, calmly got up. She went to their bedroom. She found some pieces of jewelry. She immediately went out, sold that jewelry, and went and bought enough food to fix this amazing meal, an amazing feast, he called it. He said it was just the most amazing, one of the most amazing meals they'd ever had, a sumptuous feast. And some other family members scolded her. They said, "What are you doing? Is this the time to celebrate?" But she told them that the time for joy is now when we need it most, not next week. And her courage, he said, rallied the family. They were also encouraged by this. They got together to figure out a way to overcome the present crisis, and they did. Now is the time to have joy. Now is the time to experience God's grace and God's presence. Not next week, not next month, not next year. How about right now? And by experiencing God's grace, the fullness of God's strength and God's grace and God's power right here, right now, that can so energize us that it moves us forward in faith. It'll energize those around us to be encouraged. They will experience our joy. They'll see the joy in us, the peace in us, not from ourselves. It's from God. Amen. It's not from our power. It is from God's power working in us. It's that resurrection power of walking with a risen Savior every day. I want to leave you with that thought. Now is the time to experience joy. Let's celebrate. Let's celebrate Jesus. Let's celebrate his strength, his power in us as never before. It will so energize us. It'll give us strength to move forward with a newfound faith, a closeness with God, a close walking with Christ, unlike anything we have experienced. Amen and amen. Consider it all joy, my friends, when you face trials of every kind, because the testing of your faith produces perseverance. And perseverance, when it's had its perfect work in us, makes us mature and lacking nothing. Amen. I hope that throughout the rest of this week, you will be encouraged, that you'll walk in a newfound joy, a newfound strength, a newfound power in Jesus Christ. Amen. I'm going to pray and I'm going to send us out with a song as we wrap up this evening. And again, to my old friends, I got to see you tonight. God bless you all. And send me a private message sometime. Let me know how you're doing. And keep in touch, keep connected. Hopefully on Sunday, this coming Sunday on Mother's Day. I have a message, a challenge for all of us, but a special message for ladies, for mothers. Tune in Sunday morning, 10 o'clock, right here on my Facebook channel for Sunday morning worship at 10 o'clock at Greenfield Baptist Church. It's a public live stream, so you don't have to be my Facebook friend to take part. Tell somebody, give them a link to my Facebook page. You do not be a Facebook friend with me to participate. Just find my Facebook page. You'll find this live stream. And hopefully we'll have a word very soon here about when we'll be meeting again for worship services. Our governor of Virginia is talking about opening everything up. Maybe even next week. He spoke about the 14th, opening up everything. And everybody the go-ahead, because thank God the numbers of the virus are evening out. The numbers of hospitals that are needing personal protective equipment, that's going down and evening out. So thank God for that. Look forward to seeing you all in person very soon. Stay connected. Remember, pray, stay in the Word, stay connected, and envision what God's going to do. I love you all. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for what's been a wonderful time together with my brothers and sisters in Christ. So many have joined us. Oh God, what a blessing to see these folks connecting, interacting with each other, Lord. I love all these folks and so many of them, oh God. I haven't seen here in a while, Lord. I love these dear brothers and sisters in Christ. And Lord, for those who are going through dark valleys right now, God, give them that joy that comes only from you. Encourage us tonight, oh God, to stand firm and trust you in the midst of the present situation, Lord. We know, dear God, you've got a plan. We'll trust you, Lord, till you call us home to you, or you come to receive us unto yourself, Lord. Either one, Lord, we know we're winners either way. Give us that faith and resolve to keep going to a better, brighter day. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I love you all. God bless you as you're clicking off here and going back about your business. Don't forget, Tiffany Smith has a word from God. I'm going to live stream something here in a little bit. Tiffany, look forward to that. And we'll see you all on Sunday morning, 10 o'clock.
Great is the Lord, he is worthy and true, by his power we trust in his love. Great is the Lord, he is holy and just, by his power we trust in his love. Great is the Lord and worthy of glory, great is the Lord and worthy of praise. Great is the Lord, now lift up your voice, now lift up your voice, great. Great is the Lord. Great is the Lord.
Amen. Great is the Lord. We'll see you all Sunday morning. Have a great rest of the week. Love you all.